Muy bien. Very good. De tantos lugares donde laboré por casi 30 años, hoy, today, decidí hablar solamente de uno de ellos, de uno de tantos lugares, porque el tiempo no es suficiente para hablar de tantos durante esos 30 años en el ministerio.
During my 29 years of service, I choose to talk about this mountain range because of a reason that I will tell you towards the end. There were many places, but I chose this one.
Quiero decirles de paso que el lugar que voy a mencionarles fue el accidente del avión American Airlines en el mes de diciembre del año 1995, cuando murieron 159 personas.
But over here, at this, at the same place, in December of 1995, it was the same place where 150 people died during the American Airlines plane crash, as you can see in the picture.
Además de atender pueblos y ciudades,
even though I visited towns and cities,
había congregaciones dispersas en las montañas, en esas extensas y empinadas cordilleras.
There were three congregations in different locations around the area, and I could only visit once each every month.
Como los campos eran tan extensos, podía visitarlos algunos lugares cada mes. Si me permiten, menciono el medio de transporte, ¿no? Eran carros. Allá en Colombia se le dicen chivas. Carros sin ventanas, descubierto totalmente, en cada hilera de sillas, no tan bonitas como estas, cabían aproximadamente de 8 a 9 personas.
So I would like to tell you more about the transportation going to these mountains. The way that it was is we would use some type of bus, but these were not like the ones that you can imagine, like the ones that we have here. The seats were not like the ones that we can see over here or even in buses. The bus was totally with no windows. You can see through. They didn't even have doors, and between 8 to 9 people were fitting on each booth.
Al llegar al caserío, esperaba a un hermano o a una hermana que bajaba en caballo a recibirme y poder entonces ascender, subir al lugar donde iba a visitar.
Hiking up to the mountain, riding a horse, when it was available, it was a release. Sometimes I had a brother and sister in Christ who would meet me down to walk with me, or even I had to ride alone.
El trayecto era largo, arduo y empinado.
The road was really long, it was taking me a long time, and it was very, very high.
Cuando los hermanos por alguna razón no podían bajar a recibirme, tenía que ascender la montaña caminando. Caminando.
When there were nobody coming to meet me, I had to walk, and it was not fun.
A veces eran 3 o 4 horas caminando.
Like I said before, it will take me 3 to 4 hours walking.
Descansaba de vez en cuando.
Taking some breaks, sometimes.
Los hermanos en estos lugares recorren horas de camino, bien sea caminando o a caballo.
Our brothers and sisters takes hours to go into this place, even riding a horse or even walking.
Ya miré la proyección del accidente de American Airlines en el año 1995.
As you can take, that was a picture of the accident when the airlines airplane crash in 1995.
Pasaba muy cerca de este accidente al visitar este campo.
I was walking very close by to this place when I was going to my destination.
Los hermanos hicieron todo lo posible por ayudar en este accidente.
Our brothers and sisters did everything that it was possible to help during this accident.
Cuando mi esposa y mis hijos, Evelyn y Roberto Andrés, podían acompañarme, el tiempo de tres horas o cuatro horas se prolongaba más.
When my family, my wife, my two kids, they will come with me to this mission, the time that I was facing, it was even longer.
Debía esperarlos.
I had to wait.
Una vez vivimos un tiempo de susto. Evelyn tenía aproximadamente 11 años y el hermanito tenía aproximadamente 6 años. Antes de subirla al caballo, yo le expliqué: Evelyn, el freno del caballo es así, ten mucho cuidado. De pronto el caballo, donde subimos a Evelyn, corre velozmente, Evelyn se asusta, se pierde en una curva y escuchamos un grito. Corrimos yo y mi esposa con todas las fuerzas que podía haber en estas piernas. El tiempo se nos hizo eterno, pero llegamos, Evelyn estaba en el suelo, la miramos, gracias a Dios, fue un rasguño solamente. Y el golpe, por supuesto.
I remember when Evelyn was 11 years old and my son was only 6, we taught her how to ride a horse. That was the way of transportation. Or we thought we did. And there were some pictures over there.
Ahí estamos en un descanso más o menos a la mitad de la cordillera.
That is a place where we stopped and it was almost halfway to our destination, up the hill.
Cansados, exhaustos.
We were tired, we were exhausted.
Aproveché ese descanso para un momento de romance. ¿Lo miran?
I took a chance to give a little love to my wife, as you can tell in the picture.
Roberto Andrés también me acompañó en esa ocasión. ¿Lo ve en serio? Tuve que regañarlo, no me acuerdo por qué.
That is my son, Robert. He was with me on the mission. He was upset. I had to tell him something. I don't really remember what it was. But moving forward with the story about Evelyn, she was riding a horse, and we thought, or I guess I did thought, how to really ride a horse. I told her how to stop, but that didn't happen. That didn't go well. The horse ran and ran away, and it was up to the curve when the horse stopped. I could hear yell and scream, and we ran as fast as we could, and then we saw Evelyn. She was on the floor, but thank God, like I said before, God was with us during all this mission, and she only was hurt just a bit. She had a bruise, but this was very scary for us.
Había que tener mucho cuidado en lo que decíamos desde el púlpito, en lo que se predicaba desde el púlpito. Cualquier cosa cualquier palabra podía ser peligrosa porque los movimientos alzados en arma enviaban espías a las iglesias a ver qué decía el pastor.
When preaching, I had to be very, very careful because the informal armed forces could have sent someone to listen what I was saying and maybe find a way to kick me out and not to hear God's message.
Acudían no para escuchar lo que enseña Dios en su santa palabra, sino para detectar cualquier palabra que les causara molestia, y la expresión que se usaba al detectar algo indebido en lo que se compartía era: usted no vuelva más por este lugar.
If they find a way or any word that I was saying that it was not okay for them, they will use this expression: you cannot come back anymore to this place.
El campesino allá está contra la espada y la pared.
People over there from the mountains, they are basically in between the lines.
Cualquier favor hecho a uno es confrontado por el otro.
Any favors that they do to each other or even to strangers is going to face consequences.
Un hermano tuvo que huir por esta causa.
I had a brother in Christ who had to run away because of this.
Y una vez me tocó la ceremonia fúnebre de un hermano. Claro, él se había ausentado de la iglesia. No sabemos si fue la guerrilla o fueron los paramilitares que lo mataron.
At one point I had to attend and did the funeral for one of our brothers. Even though he was away from church, we didn't even know if that was the cause of his death.
A pastores de otras congregaciones se les quitó la vida.
Pastors from other congregations also lost their lives.
Ancianos de nuestras iglesias eran amenazados.
Our old elders, they were threatened.
Colportores desaparecidos.
Our youth, who also sell books to survive, they were also disappeared.
Conocí a una hermana cuyo esposo nunca volvió.
I have one of my brothers, my sisters in Christ, whose husband never come back.
Hace algunos años un colega fue secuestrado.
A few years ago, one of my co-workers, he was taken in captivity.
Estuvo privado de la libertad por casi un año aproximadamente.
He couldn't get free for like a year.
Gracias a Dios y a la mediación de nuestros dirigentes de la Unión Colombiana del Sur, fue dejado en libertad. En el momento es secretario de la Unión Colombiana mencionada.
But after prayers and mediation from the Colombian unit, he was able to set free. Now he is serving as a secretary for the same union.
Ya tienen la idea, los hermanos allá llegan a caballo, otros caminando.
The whole idea and the whole point of this is that our brothers and sisters in Christ over there, they had to either walk or use a horse to go to their destination.
No se ven carros.
You can't see any cars.
No hay parqueaderos.
No parking spaces.
Se ven caballos.
You can only see horses.
Hermanos, la mejor noticia es que el mensaje evangélico avanza y muchas almas en Colombia llegan a los pies de Jesús.
In summary, the best news is that God's message is being shared and many souls in Colombia are touched.
No todo es sombrío.
Not everything is dark.
La luz del Evangelio ilumina a Colombia y al mundo.
The light of the word of God shines over there in Colombia and everywhere in the world.
La paz de Cristo está en muchos corazones. A pesar de los peligros y las limitaciones, la obra no se detiene.
Jesus Christ brings peace to many hearts, even though there are dangers and limitations. His teachings never stop.
Mira que te mando que te esfuerces y seas valiente. No temas ni desmayes, porque Jehová tu Dios estará contigo donde quiera que vayas. Josué 1:9.
Have I not commanded you? Be strong of good and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Joshua 1:9.
Gracias, Pastor Charles, por este privilegio. Muchas bendiciones para todos. Les amo. I love you.
We're going to pray for this dear brother's ministry. Just join me right here. Yeah. I mean, you think about it, and you've pastored your current district for decades, I understand, under situations that were life-threatening many times, as we have heard. This is real dedication. And the reason that Brother Torres is alive is because his guardian angel has been working overtime. Let us pray. Father, this is your servant. He has poured his life out. He and his wife have poured out their lives and their children in service to you. And I pray, Father, that you will bless him in his continued years of service. Bless them. And I pray, Lord, that you will send your angels time and again to watch over them. When Jesus comes, I pray that there will be many stars in their crowns of souls saved under very adverse situations. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Gracias, Pastor. Gracias por la invitación.
Good morning, church family.
Morning.
Today's scripture reading is found in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 8 through 11. And it reads, "For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fail according to the same example of disobedience."
Good morning. So now is the time for the Garden of Prayer. But first, before we kneel down here before the Lord, there are several prayer requests. Brianna Turner, which is the granddaughter of Priscilla. Tanner, a friend of Rhonda and Philip. Bob Britton, my father's wife's uncle, I guess it's my mother's uncle, that's weird. For health and spiritual, Mary Carter's a neighbor of mine and Jennifer's. She is in the IC unit, so we just need prayer for her for healing. And then there's Dorothy Fisher, who is age 97, Sally Tilbury's mother, suffered a broken hip. So, and I'm sure there are plenty of unspoken requests. But as we congregate here before, I ask that each one of us remember these in prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much that it's Sabbath. Thank you so much that what this means, a day of rest, that we get to spend with each other in honor and glory to you. Dear Heavenly Father, I ask right now for these prayer requests that we've presented before you, that you provide them healing, spiritually, physically, mentally, whatever they so need. All the unspoken requests too, we ask that you be with each one of them now. Dear Heavenly Father, I ask that you be with Pastor Ferguson as he brings us this message of how to labor to rest. Whatever what that means to us, and as we can each take that and grow our own spiritual journey. As it's stated in Philippians 2, therefore, if there are any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. That is my prayer, dear Heavenly Father, that this congregation be able to put aside their self-interest, to look forward to saving others. As we look in this time of peril, as we look in this world and see all the hate and all the just the disunity that's out there, we ask that this church come together in unity and look forward to be able to take this message to others. Help us to understand again what this message will receive today. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father. All these things I pray in your name. Amen.
Time for our praise music this Sabbath, and it's such a vital part of our worship service is to be able to sing and lift our voices to God and praise Him for what He's done for us. And so up on the screen, if you see, our first song is He Leadeth Me. So please join us in singing. Also, actually, I wanted to, Cole, would you read Psalm 100 as we begin our praise?
Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations.
Me.
Praise song this Sabbath, you're going to have to blow the dust off the hymnals and open them up to hymn number 290. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Brooke wanted us to use the hymnal, so that's what we're going to do. Mercies, hymn 290.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's life for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Third stanza.
His word shall not fail you. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Amen. Please stand for opening hymn. Guide me, all thou great Jehovah. Destruction, let me save on Canaan's side. Songs of praises, songs of praises, I will ever give to thee. I will ever give to thee.
Happy Sabbath, church. I think I've decided that this is the best seat when you guys are singing because it is excellent sounding from here. It's just, I don't know how to explain it, but it is much better than being in the back. I'll have to say that much. So I'm thankful that we're all here today, thankful that we're able to be together. Today's offering is for the local church budget. Jesus told two of his disciples to go to the village next door. He said, "You shall find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, you shall say, the Lord hath need of them." That's Matthew 21, 2 and 3. Now, I kind of think that's an interesting story because this day and age, if somebody came up to you and just jumped in your car and without asking, you would kind of be like, who are you? What are you doing in my vehicle? And in this particular story, this is when Jesus was making his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. He was being presented as a king. So this day and age, a king would not be riding a donkey. They might be riding in a limousine or something very, very fancy. So imagine if somebody came along and decided that if you were a limousine driver and jumped in your limousine and said, the Lord hath need of it. What would be your first response? I would be kind of wondering, who are you? I might even ask, can I have your driver's license? Do you have insurance? Are you, all these questions would come to mind. But in this case, that's not what happened. Your reply would be, the Lord have need of it. And the answer would be, okay, go ahead and take it. That's how we should respond if that was our circumstance. If I was the limo driver, that would be the right answer. I'm not sure I would provide it, but the Lord was guiding and leading. The disciples followed the instructions of Jesus. The owner of the two animals accepted their answer. They brought the animals to their master. God had worked through that owner. He touched the heart of the owner. The Bible does not explain how this happened, but the owner had already had everything prepared for Jesus. There are times in our lives when God sends a messenger to notify us that God needs us for some special purpose. Sometimes those types of things make me nervous. We don't always understand, but we can know the Lord is calling. So what do you do? Do you listen to the voice of God and walk into the unknown? Or do you ignore his voice? God wants to use you, all of you, to meet the needs of the various ministries of his church. You'll often hear the voice of God and sense the Lord speaking to you to bring your gifts to him. Now, right now, we're having an offering call, but your gifts are not just money or your means. They're your talents, your time, your contributions to others, working, relationships, many different ways that we can serve the Lord and we can present our gifts to him. Let us pray. Lord, thank you so much for your many blessings to us. Lord, you give us so much. We often take it for granted. We don't realize the many ways you bless us. So, Lord, as we are collecting an offering today, I pray that you would allow us to be generous with gratitude for the many ways you provide for us. Lord, I pray for a special blessing on these means, that they would do the work that you have designed for them to do, that we could bless this community and this church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. is a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was no gone and my heart had no song, even then God was waiting
Jaza.
Yeah.
Come to camp meeting in Amen. June and sing that song, please. Yeah. Wow. We can have the benediction now, and we've been blessed by a wonderful message from Pastor Torres. I tell you, there's always something special here at Kernersville Church on Sabbath. You cannot determine how the Spirit's going to lead, but we've been blessed. And let me get it right now. Cole and Evelyn will be married 2 weeks from tomorrow, right? Yeah. It's a special gal you're getting. She stared down one time those assassins. Got separated from the rest of the family up there in the mountain. She told me about it. And she realized they could have snuffed her life out like that. And she just smiled at him and acted like she's a Jesus girl. They let her pass. That's like trying to get out of Afghanistan right now. You need to show them how to do it over there, how to get out. All right, this is Labor Day weekend. Think about that just a moment. I looked at this sign this week, and it said, closed Labor Day, a restaurant. Closed. Wait. Isn't that kind of a contradiction? If we really are celebrating labor, shouldn't we work on Labor Day? Huh? Shouldn't we, just tell our boss, I'm working free this Monday. Has anyone thought of that? Yeah. I will celebrate labor by working free. So I did a little investigation on Labor Day. And I found out that it was born during the time of the Industrial Revolution. There were actually riots taking place. Lives were being lost in the street. Fights were going on between the working class and those who owned the big tamale, you know. Yeah. And the working conditions were horrible. The pay was horrible. They were working 7 days a week in factories where there was not air, there was not horrible working conditions, no light. Children were being chained to machines, and they had to work as well. And the people who were blessed were those who were in the agricultural industry. But even then, there were those who were forced to work, not go to school. And so at this time, right in the middle, the Industrial Revolution ended with World War I. In the 1800s, this guy, President Grover Cleveland, signed into law a day celebrating not work, but it is the labor of the man that they're celebrating. Yeah. The man. And of course they said man, but today they would say mankind. No, they couldn't even say that. What would be the politically correct thing to say? The labor, period. Correct. But you understand what they meant in the Declaration, that they were celebrating the working man and woman. And out of that came an understanding of what was being accomplished. But it is kind of, it got my mind thinking, there are things in the Bible that seem to be contradictory, like Hebrews 4, verse 11. Last week I talked about the Sabbath. We're continuing with that. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into his rest. Think about it just a moment. Those two words I've highlighted in yellow. Let us labor to enter into rest. If you want to rest, why not just quit laboring and rest? Now, my wife had me out working 2 days this week. We worked from sun up to sundown. I mean, she can work. First time I worked with her, I put on my blue jeans and my overalls, I guess it was, got a wheelbarrow, and went out, thought we'd work 2 hours and go water ski. Oh, no. 4 or 5 hours into it, I said, you don't plan on quitting today, do you? She says, quit? Why? Sun hasn't set yet. And that's the way it was these 2 days. We saw the storm coming in, and it was her opportunity to get out there and work. When you work and you need rest, what do? You quit working. And we needed rest, didn't we? At the end of the day, we stopped working. Here it says, do you want to enter into rest? Labor to enter into rest. That seems contradictory, doesn't it? There are other things in the Bible that seem contradictory. faith without works is dead. Wait a second. I thought we're saved totally by faith. Then why do we read that faith without works is dead? Of course, if you have the right faith, it will produce works. So you have to look and see what the Bible has to say. For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves, Hebrews 2, 8, 9, not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. The gift of, oh, there's nothing I can do. The only thing I can do is, oh, there is something I can do then. What is that? Accept it. God will never force himself on us. We must accept it. The only option, other option, would be predestination, where we're predestined to be saved and we have no decision at all. No, the Bible is very clear. We must accept it. Jesus says, if any man will come unto me, we must come unto Jesus. I will in no wise cast him out. But back to this, Hebrews 4, verse 11. What does it mean when it says, let us labor, therefore, to enter into his rest? What does it mean to labor, to enter rest? And what is the rest? The R-E-S-T that is referred to here in Hebrews 4, verse 9. Back up. That's Hebrews 4, 11. Backing up, though, just three verses. This helps us. It says, there remaineth, therefore, a rest to the people of God. We're talking about this rest that remains for the people of God. Time does not permit us to look at the whole chapter of Hebrews 4, but the context is that Paul, I believe, wrote Hebrews. He is saying that the Israelites never entered into the rest. For 40 years, they wandered in the wilderness. God told them, you can go over and enter into the rest. They had to wander around 40 years because of unbelief, he says. Then eventually they did get into, after the 40 years, they did get into Israel. But what Paul has said is, even then they did not enter into the rest. They got the land, but they did not enter into the rest. They kept rebelling. About every 70 years they rebelled. They did not enter into the rest. Therefore, and then when Jesus the Messiah came, they crucified him. They did it. He says, come unto me and I'll give you what? Rest. Did they come unto him? The vast majority did not. So he's saying there remains, therefore, a rest to the people of God. There are some distractors, some criticizers, some naysayers who say there is no place in the Bible after the cross where we find the Sabbath being referred to where we must do it. And all right, there's no place. There's inference where you see they keep it. See, Paul, he kept it. All the disciples kept the Sabbath. There are those who say they did that because they were just trying to reach the Jews, but they actually worshiped on another day. There's no place in the Bible that says they worshiped on the first day of the week. No place. There was a Saturday night meeting they had, but they always worshiped when they got together on Sabbath. That Saturday night meeting, of course, Paul the next day, on Sunday, he didn't worship. He walked across a continent to catch a boat. But back to our scripture, it says, there remains, therefore, a rest of the people of God. Now, nudge the person next to you. You got to wake up and see this. You don't have to know Greek to get this. You will see it. I'm going to share some Greek with you. Look at that word for rest. There remaineth, therefore, this is the only place in the Bible this word is used. This particular word is used. There remaineth, therefore, a sabbatismos. Do you hear Sabbath in that? There remains, it literally can be translated Sabbath rest. There remaineth, therefore, a rest, a sabbatismos, a Sabbath rest for the people of God. It screams out for us that if you've come to the cross and you've accepted Jesus Christ, enter into his rest. And the sign for that rest, this side of the cross, is the seventh day Sabbath. That's it. The fourth commandment is the reference here. Now, yes, it says you can enter into the rest that Jesus offers you. You are free now. You've come out of Babylon. You've come out of Egypt. You've come out of a life of sin, you've accepted Jesus, you enter into the spiritual rest, and the sign of that rest is the Sabbath. It's interesting that there are two renderings of the Ten Commandments. One is in Exodus 20, verses 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. And also, I should have this up there, but I don't. Deuteronomy, the fifth chapter. You can look at it later. In the Exodus version, it says we should keep the Sabbath holy because God created the heavens and the earth, and the sea and all that in them is. He's a creator. But in Deuteronomy 5, it says we keep the Sabbath because Jesus has led us out of sin. The Exodus, we're all part of the Exodus. When we come out of sin and we give our hearts to Jesus, and the Sabbath is a sign of our Creator and our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Reminds us that we do not make ourselves, we do not save ourselves, we come unto Him and we rest. And that rest is freely given. We come out of sin, it's freely given. He recreates us, He changes us. So the stuff we used to love to do, we no longer like to do. I mean, I've told you stories of people when I first came here that were in sin's grasp. They said, I cannot do this. I cannot give up this alcohol. I cannot give up this philandering. I cannot do this. I can't give up my cocaine. I can't do it. But Jesus did it for them. And they know it. And today they're worshiping in God's house on God's day because God gave them victory. They came out of it. Now, maybe you don't have problems like that, but we all have problems with self, don't we? We all have problems with anger. We all have problems with envy. We have whatever. The devil studies us. He can't read our mind, but he studies us, and he throws us into the situation that he can really, things can get under our skin, and we can lose our religion. You know that. There's no exception. We're all like that. But when we come to Jesus, we rest in him, and he changes us, for we are his workmanship, saved unto what? Good works. Ephesians 2, verse 9. Ezekiel 20, verse 12 says, I also gave them my Sabbaths, Sabbaths, to be a sign between them and me. The Sabbath is still a sign between God and his people. The seventh day Sabbath is still a sign. But who are God's people today? You ask a person out on the street about this, and they'll say, oh, it's the Jews. The Jews are wonderful people. The Lord Jesus Christ died for Jews and Gentiles. But the only way that you can be a child of God is not by being born in the right family. The only way is to be born again into the family of God. You see? And so God's people are Jews or Gentiles who have accepted Jesus Christ. The Sabbath is a sign, not just for the Jews, but for the Gentiles as well, for the Christians. The New Testament Christian church is New Israel. Israel plays no part in the Bible anymore as being God's chosen nation or people. I'm not anti-Semitic. I wish that all of Israel today, all of my Jewish friends, would accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Did you know that in my neighborhood back in Hendersonville, there is a Seventh-day Adventist Messianic church? That's right. Right across the street from the hospital, Advent Hospital, Advent Health, is a man. We believe in ministering to our Jewish friends. I'm not anti-Semitic again. You simply say Jews or and people will be, listen, is he anti-Semitic? No, I'm not. I wish as Paul did. He says, I wish that they would all be saved. The Sabbath is a sign between God and his people. That's the bottom line. That is New Testament teaching, the seventh-day Sabbath. Hebrews 4, verse 9 again. There remains then, this is the New International Version, there remains then a Sabbath rest. See, that's a translation in a modern translation. There remains, now this is not a Seventh-day Adventist translation that you're seeing on the screen. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Let us labor to enter into his rest. How do we labor to do that? Am I being legalistic when I keep the Sabbath, when I determine I'm not going to have my TV on and watch a movie or watch something secular? Is that legalism? When I turn the secular music off, is that legalism? Why do I do that? Am I trying to get brownie points with God? Huh? When Sharon and I determine we like to read a lot, we go on vacation and we just sit there and read together on the beach or whatever, you know, we just like to read. But we put aside our secular reading. Do we do that because we're legalist? Why do we do that? Because I want, as we sang today, thank you for that song, guys. We want to turn our eyes upon Jesus, and we don't need distraction, secular distraction. I'm talking about laboring, making effort. You see, making effort to make Sabbath or let Sabbath be a spiritual day, a day in Christ. When we determine that we're going to do something entertaining, we determined, you know, that there are certain boundaries. I love to play golf. Golf doesn't like me, by the way, but I like to play it. It's masochistic, I guess. The more I play, the worse I get. But I don't play is there anything wrong with golf? I don't think so, really. But I don't do it on the Sabbath. I grew up on a lake. Our boat did not pull water skiers on the Sabbath in the home I grew up with. It was a mode of transportation. If you went to the other side of the lake, it would take 3 minutes by boat. It would take 15 minutes by car. So we used it as transportation. A friend of mine came to visit me. His dad was a pastor. He says, I can't get in the boat and go to the other side of the lake. I said, why, John? He says, because we use the boat throughout my life to water ski. I said, well, I live on a lake. We do that, but we don't do it on the Sabbath. So he got in his car and drove around. He was laboring. You know, it made him feel comfortable. I got in the boat and went across and beat him by 12 minutes. Now, you have to be determined. You have to determine who is right. What I'm saying is God hasn't shown me in the Bible, you know, who is right there. But we were both doing the same thing, making effort. That really is what it means here when it says labor to enter into his rest. Put your mind in gear and make effort. Oh, there it is. Hebrews 4, verse 11, New International Version again. Let us make every effort to enter that rest from his own works so that no one will fail. Fight the good fight of faith is a similar contradictory term. Fight the good fight of faith. How can faith be a fight? Faith is something that we don't do. All we can do is lay hold by faith onto Christ. But this is similar with the same term there that says make every effort to enter into rest. Fight the good fight of faith. Why not just turn your back and walk away? Why do you need to stand up and fight? Why do you need to get embroiled in a fight for faith? Those are two opposite ends of the spectrum, aren't they? Fight and faith. What does Paul mean? Well, I drew a little illustration again. About 2-3 weeks ago, I did this. I'm going to do it again. Okay. Here's the fight of faith. I got this from Morris Fenton. Does anyone remember Morris Fenton? Yeah. Felt my call to ministry during a Morris Fenton week of prayer at Southern Adventist University when I was a student there. And I remember him using this illustration before PowerPoint. He said there are two fights. There's a fight of faith and there's a fight of works. And we're told to fight the fight of faith, not the fight of works. I remember Morris Vinden said, can you imagine, since it wasn't PowerPoint, he said, imagine drawing a line from this pulpit straight up through the roof all the way to the throne of God. That is the fight of faith, where I look upward. I'm fighting to keep my eyes on Jesus, as the song said. Look in his wonderful face. And then there's a fight of works. The devil comes in the fight of works, and he knocks on the door, and he says, here, I'm come here to tempt you today. Where would you like to get started? I have some ideas, the devil says. I've been studying you. And so we slug it out all day long, and at the end of the day, I find that I lost. He won. Because the devil's bigger than me. And I'll always lose, and you'll always lose, when we fight the fight of works. But Paul says, fight the fight of faith, he tells Timothy. What does that mean, to fight the fight of faith? The fight of faith is the vertical life, where I fight to spend time with Jesus. I fight to keep my eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. The horizontal life is navel gazing. It's always trying to find something else about me that should be changed, and always trying to make myself right, saying, yeah, God, I'm trying. I'm working on it. Philippians 4, verse 13 says, I can do all things through Christ. Did you get that? This is the fight of faith we're talking about here in Philippians. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Christ works through my hand. He works through my mind. He works through my mouth. I'm a diabetic. I was addicted to donuts. I've told you that. I've eaten a dozen donuts at one sitting. I bought 2 dozen. I walked into Krispy Kreme Donuts. And I saw up there, it says 2 dozen, half price. I said, that's good stewardship. I'm not kidding you. On the way home, 5 blocks on the way home, I stuffed 12 in my mouth as fast as I could. I took the empty cart and I put it in the garbage can coming into the house. I left it outside. I didn't think anybody would be looking outside. I came in with 12. I said, donuts, family. And they says, Dad, don't you want one? No, I'm good. I met Mr. Krispy Kreme Donut. His father started Krispy Kreme, actually. Frank Guthrie. Frank may be watching today. Frank, first time I met Frank, his wife was a childhood friend, is a childhood friend of Sharon's. I said, Frank, so you're in the donut business? He said, yep, I am. I was chairman of the board when I retired. I said, you're the reason I got diabetes. And I told him that story, and he said, if you were doing that, you were doing other stuff you shouldn't do. Don't blame it all on me. Those are our first words to each other. He was right. It's my hand, even though I got in the mail yesterday, a coupon that said if I would buy 12, I would get a 2nd one free. I threw that thing in the garbage as fast as I could. Now, there's nothing wrong with Krispy Kreme donuts if you practice temperance, I believe. But for me, it's death. It's a death nail as a diabetic. It was not anyone else's hand but mine that did this to the donuts. You understand? It's my hand that stands up or gets the remote and does this to change the channel when the wrong thing's on. It's my hand that does something to the computer when the wrong thing comes up on the computer. It's my hand that does it. But it's Christ in me, it says, that gives me the ability to use my mind. It's my mind that's thinking, that's in gear, to say no to the devil. I can slug it out all day with the devil on my own. He's going to win. It's my mouth that bites my tongue, but it's God looking to Jesus. Look unto Jesus, sinless is he. Remember that song? Father, impute his life unto me. My life a scarlet, my sin and woe, cover with his life whiter than snow. Do you know who wrote that? The author of these words had a nephew named Frankie Belden. He wrote that song, and he would write his songs while the preacher was preaching and have it ready and sing it at the end of the sermon. It's one of those songs. Deep are the wounds transgression has made. Red are the stains. My soul is afraid. Oh, to be covered, Jesus, with thee, safe from the law that now judgeth me. That's a fight of faith again. The law condemns us. We fight this faith. Fight of faith. One more. I thought I had another one there. Maybe not. Okay. Philippians 2, verse 13. It is God which works in you both to will of his good pleasure. Here it is. God works in us. I want you to see that. We are not to look at ourselves, no navel gazing. Do you remember? I have children, and I remember when my baby boy discovered his belly button. And you say, don't talk about that sort of thing here. Listen, it happens. And we had to put a big Band-Aid over it. How many Christians are navel gazing? Just focusing on, oh, I can't get over this. I've tried and tried, Lord. I've tried and tried. I'm just hopeless. I'm just helpless, you know. I don't like me, and I understand if you don't like me. I've heard people actually say those things. They're navel-gazing. We are not to look at ourselves. The more we dwell on our own imperfections, that's the vertical life, the horizontal life, the less strength we have to overcome them. So stop it. That's it. So what am I to do? Look unto Jesus. Cover with his life, as Frankie Belden wrote. I'm going to end with this illustration. David fought the fight of faith. He fought Goliath. Goliath says, send me a man. Send me a man. David came forward. He volunteered for the job. Saul said, what are you thinking? You're just a boy. Saul called David a boy. Goliath said, send me a man. He talked Saul into letting him go. That's what the fight really looked like right there. If you were wagering, I know you don't do that. I know you don't do that. I don't either. But just think about it. If you did, who would you be betting on? And that was two armies, two mighty armies. You bet they were wagering on who's going to win this battle. And everybody was saying, even David's side was saying, put me down for 5. No, make it 10 for Goliath. What was he thinking? The words had not been inspired, had not been written yet, but he knew the principle. Philippians 4, verse 19, my God shall supply all your need. That's what David was thinking. David said, the Lord delivered me from the hand of the lion and the bear. He will deliver me now out of the hand of this Philistine. That's what he was thinking. And that's what we hold up to God. Not my track record, Lord. It's your track record. Jesus never fails. Jesus never fails. Earth and heaven may pass away, but what? Do you believe that? Yes. So Goliath sees. He says, I sent a man. What are you sending out to me? I'm insulted. I'll feed you to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. And David interrupts him. David says, you came to me with a sword, spear, and a shield, but I come to you in, he's looking at a guy that's covered with armor. and he has a shield bearer in front of him. He has a spear that's longer than he is tall and weighs about as much as he weighed. I come to you with the only thing he had going for him, in the name of the Lord. And this is an example of how we fight the fight of faith. The Lord will deliver you into my hand, Goliath. I'm not going to argue with you. What did he have in his pocket? 5 rocks and a homemade sling. He says, I have in my pocket a rock, and I'm all like, no. The Lord will do it. I have nothing. For the battle is the Lord's. Isn't that wonderful? That's the way we fight every day. We go out every day. We wake up every day. That's the fight of faith. And so David, notice in the Bible, it says he ran towards Goliath. And as he's running, it's his hand that takes out of his pouch a rock that he had picked up out of the 5. He puts it in the sling. He's done this thousands of times, and he slung the sling. Now, just notice the action words. He ran. He took. He slung the sling, if that's the correct grammar, excuse me. It goes on and says he actually took a sword out of David, of God. This was God working. Goliath pushes back his helmet, and the only vulnerable place was right here. You think David's guardian angel might have had a hand in making sure that rock hit that bullseye? And David knew it. That's why he said, the battle is the Lord's. All these action words are for you to know that there is something that will happen if you let God do it. It's not you doing it apart from it. It's letting God do it. And he'll change your heart. He's changed my heart. 70 pounds ago, I was told I have diabetes from eating all those donuts and everything else. I haven't tried to lose 1 pound. I know there are some wives here, it happens everywhere I go, that nudge their husband and say, I don't want you to get that skinny. I had nothing to do with it. I was addicted to Dr. Pepper's, full strength. I never drank water. But that's another story. I'm just telling you, it's my story that Jesus did it for me. I was on 6 meds, 50% blockage. I was dying. I should be under the ground now. And God did it. We are in a fight today like we have never been. But as we look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, as we enter into his rest, we'll find peace in our soul that we have never known before. So my folks, today, make every effort to enter into that rest. I'm going to close with this, Romans 8, verse 37. Yet in all these things we are what? More than conquerors through him who loved us. I invite you to stand with me and sing that old hymn, trust and what?
Obey.
Obey. That's the fight of faith. Trust and obey.
Trust and obey, for they there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His love quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Before I have the closing prayer, I'd like to remind the elders of your meeting immediately. Leave here and go immediately. We're going to have an elders meeting. And also, last week we were blessed with the baptismal service and we saw Joy Snyder baptized. She was here, is here this morning. And Joy's mother is under hospice care, was taken under hospice care, is given hours, it appears, to remain in this world. And so I'm going to pray for Kathy, Joy's mother, at this time as well, this benediction. Father, thank you so much for the promise that you will never leave or forsake us, that the battle is not ours, the battle is not the devil's, the battle is yours. Lord, may we seek your face constantly, hour by hour, second by second. May we look to you. Bless us in our devotional life. Bless us, Lord, as we go about our work, our secular work, our family responsibilities. Bless all that we do. May we look to you at every corner, at every turn. Lord, keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. We pray, Lord, for Kathy. Lord, I pray that you'll be close to Kathy, that she will know that you are her Savior and that she is not alone. I pray, Lord, that in her mind she will be drawing closer to you, that her decision at this point, at the end of her life, will be for you. Put your arms around the family, Joy and her children, Lord, her family. Comfort them at this time. Give them strength. And now I pray the Lord will bless you all and keep you until we meet again in Christ's name. Amen.